Hi, and welcome back to Femme Advantage, female empowerment for girls and for women. If this is the first video that you've tuned into, please stop at this point, go back to the first video and watch them in order, because each of these videos builds upon the one that went before, and I don't want you to miss a thing. Please also consider, if you would, subscribing to this channel so that you can receive each one of these videos just as soon as they're released. I'm glad you're back. We're in the midst of a discussion about taking relationships, especially the most significant ones to us, and reforming them into partnerships. Now, in videos before, we've talked about the difference. That the word relationship is very generic. Anyone that you have repetitive interaction with, you have a relationship with. Not every relationship's positive or helpful. But a partnership is what we go into purposefully. Basically between two people, it can be between more, but there's always going to be a one-on-one partnership that's the basis of any partnership with a group. In this session, we're talking specifically about how to construct your, at least in your mind and preferably on paper, what your agreement will look like, what this partnership structure will be like. Now, I want you to understand you're already doing this. You may have, you may be involved in a business partnership. You may be attending a university or a high school or have done so before and you received a student handbook. Maybe where you are employed, you have an employee handbook. There's certainly a list of rules somewhere about acceptable behavior, non-acceptable behavior, acceptable interaction, etc. Because any group of people striving to work together will eventually define expected or acceptable behavior. Now, often this is a tacit agreement, that it's not structured, it's not formally agreed upon, it's not even voted upon, it's just kind of accepted, it's just kind of presented, and we all just kind of live with it, or it develops kind of organically. If you've ever gone to a website and you've had a pop-up that said, this this website uses cookies. Do you give us permission to put to use cookies, to put information on your computer to help us the next time that you log on? All of these are demonstrations of partnerships. It's an agreement. In the case of cookies, if you decide you don't want that company to do that, then you're probably not going to get access into their website. That's part of the agreement. In order for you to have access to our website, we need to have access to your computer to put some code in there to help us in the future. Now, we tend to look at these agreements negatively as rules or conditions or limitations, things like that, or things that control our freedom in our desire for, if you will, limitless power. Actually, what agreements are is protection for the power needs of everyone involved. It's mutuality. It's in order to get along, in order to interact, there needs to be some understanding of what that interaction will look like, consequences if we abuse our interaction, or especially if we abuse respect for one another or power for one another. So you're already doing this. The challenge is we don't tend to do this in our most important relationships. In fact, most of the partnerships that you're in, you probably entered in passively. In the situations we talked about, a student handbook or a workplace handbook, it was given to you. Part of the condition of working here is you will follow these. And you probably looked at it as, well, these are things that I have to do rather than an agreement. But the truth is, you have the right to live or to leave. You have the right to not live by those. You have a right to not agree to those. Now, there will be consequences one way or another in doing that. But I want you to know this partnership concept is not new. We're all actually involved in it. I want you to just begin to recognize that when it occurs. This is about bringing partnership purposefully to important relationships, because we tend to slide into our most important relationships. We had no choice of parents or siblings. We have no choice of co-workers. Therefore, we're in relationships that we didn't agree to. And what's interesting is along the way, we never sit down and come to an agreement. All right, here's what I expect from you. Here's what I'm willing to give to you. The relationships we structure as partnerships tend to go better. In fact, they tend to go much better because they're clearly defined and understood. Those are the kind of partnerships that we agree to, like signing a mortgage to buy a house or getting a loan on a car, or two partners who go into a business together. They normally have a contract. And one of the reasons that the partnerships that go well tend to go well is both people respect the contract, which means they respect one another. Now, even in marriage, which is a relationship that we choose, I find that rarely do people define their expectations. I spend a lot of time in premarital counseling focusing on that very fact. We kind of fall into this relationship, or through love or romance, we kind of fall backward into a relationship, and here we are. And we have expectations, but often we don't express those. I've talked about in premarital counseling to a couple, if one of you is raised where mom took out the trash and the other of you was raised where dad took out the trash, then you're both expecting the other person to take out the trash, and you're resenting them when you don't, because in my worldview, that's the way it went. But we never talk about that. So we're going to revisit our default relationships, especially the important ones, and restructure them as partnerships. Now, as we mentioned in the last couple of videos, the place I strongly recommend that you start is the mother-daughter relationship, the mother-daughter contracted partnership. Now, if you don't have a mother, or if you don't have a living daughter, find someone who kind of plays that role in your life, a mother figure, a daughter figure, if you would, because this is the first place to start. It's the best place to start, and every relationship can be improved. And remember that we're practicing something that is new to us, so we want to do that in a safe environment. We want to do that in a relationship where the other person wants us to succeed, and we want them to succeed, and that's not always the case. It can be kind of challenging to try to practice this in other scenarios. So generally between mothers and daughters, there's some basic good communication taking place. But if not, here's a good way to start that. To have a sit down and say, I want to talk about our relationship, and I want us to kind of re-enter a relationship with a new perspective and a new direction. Now, in the description below, there is a link that you can go to and you can download for totally free a guide that will take you step by step through this agreement that you're going to establish for a partnership. Okay? Now, I'm going to strongly encourage you that you write this down, that you use the form. Regardless of how you're going to use it, I recommend that you use it because it will help you get your thoughts out where you can see them. When we see our thoughts on paper, they become much more concrete than if they're just flowing around in our head. It will help you come up with a game plan. In fact, I recommend that rather than doing that right now, go ahead and watch this video through its conclusion, then download the guide, and then go back and watch this video again, using the guide then to go step by step, and you can pause this video anytime that you need to in order to progress from one step to another. Remember, I've told you from the start, we're going to take you from wherever you are to being as empowered as you want to be step by step. So I'm with you every step of the way. And this is another way that we're going to do that. This is another series of steps actually within one step. And that's getting your partnership agreement. Now at this point, it's going to be a proposal because you haven't negotiated it yet. But this is where you start. So when you sit down, as the guide will show you, make a list of your partnership wants or needs. Here's what I need from the relationship. Here's what I want from a relationship. Now, once you've done that, make a list of the other person's wants or needs. Now, at this point, it's anticipating. If you've been around this person very long, you can anticipate some things that they want from you because they've been telling you, possibly over and over and over, okay? So when I say anticipated, you're going to anticipate what the other person, what your partner's needs or wants from you are going to be. Now, when we sit down with that person, those things are going to be negotiated. So those things will be changed. Remember, this is a guide, and it's not chiseled in stone. Now, once you've made those two lists, prioritize your list beginning with the most easily accomplished. Now, this is very important. Don't start with the one that is the toughest. Don't start with the biggie in your relationship. Start with something that is relatively small that you can focus on, that you can gain some success in the process. Do the same with your partner's list. Prioritize theirs based on what would be easiest for you to accomplish in helping to achieve their desires or their needs in the partnership, and put that at the top of their list. Now, when you sit down with them and they compare those lists with you, that order is going to change, but you now have a basis of saying, this is why I want us to work on this one first. It's because I think it's easily achievable. That's going to build closeness between us, and that's going to build success. We're going to learn how to do this through the process. And the great thing is, if we keep learning and keep practicing and trying, we can't fail. Now, we can have misunderstandings, and we go away and then come back to that. We'll talk about that later. But because we're in a love environment, because we're in an acceptance environment, the other person wants us to succeed. So we're going to practice this little by little. We want to practice with something that is, at least in our perception, it's something that the other person wants or something that we want that's relatively easy to achieve. So the next thing, and this is also very important, define your wants or your needs with behaviors. Don't use generic terms. Don't use primarily emotive terms or emotional terms. Remember, the purpose of this exercise is to bring structure to your thoughts and your interaction. And part of that structure is to assign a behavior for everything. In other words, let me give you some example. To say someone using very global terms or terms that are not very descriptive, I want you to be honest with me. I want us to live in harmony. What does that mean? I want you to be more aware of me. I wish we could live in more peace. I wish you would show me greater compassion. I need respect from you. I need nurturing from you. I wish you would show me more affection. You see, those are all very global terms, and they give us kind of a broad category, but they don't define behaviors. And what that means is the other person then interprets the term that you're using based upon their interpretation of it, and they may not be giving you at all what you're seeking, even though they think they are. You said you wanted compassion, I'm showing you compassion, but it's not the compassion that you were looking for. And this is notoriously the issue, especially between males and females. Totally different interpretations of the same words. For instance, a boy and a girl, backseat of a car. She says, I love you. He says, I love you. Do they mean the same thing? No, same word, but they don't mean the same thing. So a behavioral need description communicates and defines what you mean, such as, partner, I want you to commit to one shared activity per week of 1 hour duration. Now, you see, that's objective and measurable. The other person and you both can know if that goal is being achieved. Or, I want you to listen to me for 10 minutes each day without trying to solve anything. I want you to listen for 10 minutes, and I want you to not solve what I'm presenting to you. Or, I want you to help me find ways to improve my ideas rather than you criticizing my ideas. That way you can help me see that my idea is bad rather than you trying to convince me it's bad. See, those are measurable behaviors, and that's the point, is that it's measurable, especially by your partner. They can know when they're making progress. These are like mile markers, and we can know that we're getting somewhere. They're objective rather than entrapment. And entrapment is, I'm not going to tell you. You need to find out. And I'll tell you when you happen upon it. I'll tell you when you accidentally do it. That's not helpful. Also, they can be easily reinforced. When you get even a little of what you seek, reinforce it profoundly. Remember, if you want to increase a behavior, give it attention. If you want to decrease it, ignore it. Don't let up on the rewards. And rewards often are just verbal attaboys. The other person is learning new habits. Now, you're defining the habit. I want you to do this for this duration, this often, etc. Behavioral, define. But they're learning a new habit. And you know, anytime you've learned a habit, it means trial and error, get better, a little bit more, greater, greater, etc. So you're coaching this partnership, and they're going to be coaching you. And you win. You win if you coach well. If you help this person understand specifically what you're looking for, you're going to receive the rewards and the benefits. Obviously, both of you will. But the motivation is we're in this together. And remember, as we talked about a couple of sessions ago, when we're successful, both of us succeed to a greater level than either of us could ever do on our own. So to be successful in this partnership, for the other person to be successful means you succeed to a greater extent than you ever could without this person. Now, what you're going to be doing in sharing this agreement with when you're structuring a relationship into a partnership is you're going to practice being assertive. Now, we're going to talk much more about being assertive because most of us don't do that very well. In fact, I would suggest to you that nobody who has not received assertiveness training does assertiveness very well. There are people who are, they let you know what they think and all of those kinds of things, but they're not good at being assertive. So we're going to need to redefine that word, and we're going to need to learn how to be assertive. And assertive involves, for instance, never raising your voice, never manipulating anybody, those kinds of things. So this is the first step to practice being assertive. Now, you're probably not used to doing this. You probably seek an environment of safety. You've been taught the nice girl personality disorder, where you bend over backwards so much for other people that you break your back. The word of assertive comes from the root word assert, which means to cause others to recognize one's authority or a right by confident and persuasive behavior. So it's to cause others to recognize my authority and my rights by my confident and persuasive behavior. Now, see, I've got to be confident in it. That's why we're practicing. That's why we're practicing mother-daughter. It's easy for us in a safe environment to practice and get good. And once we get good at this, then we're going to start sharing the principles that we've learned in every relationship that we have, starting with the working toward the most challenging ones, probably last. Okay. Now, your greatest enemy right now in learning to be assertive and learning to develop and to present a partnership agreement, your greatest enemy and my greatest enemy working with you is apathy or acceptance, living lives of quiet desperation, of coming to the conclusion this is the way it is, this is the way it's supposed to be. I look around and I see other people, they're running through the same issues that I am, so this is the way it is. No, no, no. Messages like girls can't do that, or girls don't have permission to do that, mediocrity, adequacy, those kinds of things. So what we're looking for in your life is excellence. Now, you're going to define when you have achieved the empowerment that you want. I'm not here to structure you in that. I'm here to give you the tools to be able to do that. But you're going to decide when you've achieved what it is that you want to achieve. But I want you to know there's no limits to this, and I don't care what anybody around you is doing. That's the problem that we have. If you've noticed, trying to seek out resources of how to become an empowered woman, you're not finding many. And that's what keeps this mediocrity going, or just, oh, accepting my humdrum life, or I wish people would treat me better, I'm so victimized. And one of the things that frustrates me the most as a therapist is having women come into my office for counseling who have been so beat down by the world, by the opposite gender, by rules, by so many things. And by very young age, often by teenage, they've started to give up on achieving what they're capable of doing. Now, we're going to talk more about being assertive. Assertive is simply saying, this is what I need, this is what I want. Okay. What you're used to is rebellion, which is reactive aggression that creates all kinds of other problems. It squelches partnerships. When you rebel against a partner, you destroy a partnership. Also, what you're used to is venting, which is short-term emotional release, but not a long-term solution. What we're talking about in terms of establishing a partnership and being assertive is not a coping strategy. This is a strategy of victory. This is a strategy of empowerment. This is not feeling bad at the end of the day, doing something to vent so that I get rid of those bad feelings and start the next day and do the same thing over. I'm not a real fan of venting. Now, I know there's times for it, but I'm a real fan of empowerment, so I don't need to vent. It's a solution rather than a coping mechanism. And the problem with coping mechanisms, they don't overcome, they don't achieve, they just cope. They just maintain a situation. You have been taught to be passive or passive aggressive. Some of you have been taught or you've trained yourself to be aggressive. One of the things that you found is if you're aggressive, you don't have many friends. You don't respect the friends that you have. You're able to win arguments in the short term, but you're not able to establish long-term relationships. Aggression causes people to either want to leave or to fight back. When aggression is responded to with aggression, it just escalates. All right. So most have been taught to be passive. That's the nice girl personality disorder, or passive aggressive. Passive aggressive is to present aggression in a roundabout way. It's about walking out of the restaurant when you're angry at the manager because they messed up your whole meal, taking a knife and slashing the manager's tires. You're expressing aggression, but you're not expressing it in any way except passively. Aggression, any aggression, usually leads to withdrawal or resistance. People don't like aggressive people, and they tend to not center around passive aggression because they don't know. It always catches them off guard. They don't know what to do. It's a trust issue. Neither aggression nor passive aggression, and most of you have been trained to be one or both of those. Neither of those are good for building partnerships. In fact, I will say you can't build a partnership based on aggression or passive aggression. Passive aggression is a number one way that females are socialized to conflict. Rather than saying anything to someone's face, and if you look at soap operas, anything that involves drama, generally what you're going to find is a lot of passive aggression. People talking behind each other's backs, people getting teams against teams behind each other's backs. Anybody that's ever, if you're a female and you've gone to school, you know how passive aggressive females can be. And they're taught to be that because we're taught two options. One is to be passive, which nobody wants to be. The other is to be passive aggressive or aggressive. And so what happens is you're either overrun by people, you're either a doormat, or you're a witch with a capital B, and there we don't give a lot in between. Being assertive not only shows respect for the other, it draws respect from the other folks. But remember, passive aggression is the number one way females are socialized to conflict in our culture. So we want you to have safety to practice being assertive. So your mom or daughter wants you to win. Males can be very competitive, and you know that. Not a good place to practice. Bosses can try to squelch assertiveness. People in positions of power often feed on power. It's not a good place to practice, not a good place to start. Until you feel good with your skills, until you feel good with being assertive, until you feel confident in your self-respect, then what happens when you walk into the room? Respect just emanates from you. It's an aura around you. And then you're going to have successful interactions. And we're going to talk later about how to deal with one-up, one-down relationships, power differential relationships. We haven't learned how to deal with that yet. So again, we want you to practice assertiveness with safety. Now, if you don't have a mom or a daughter or a mom or daughter figure, you might want to go with friends. It's not going to be quite as good, but again, this is someone who wants you, hopefully, they're on your team and want you to succeed. But you've got to be very careful in which friend you choose. You've got to make sure this person is loyal to you so that they don't get upset at you in the process and personalities become an issue. So keep it safe. Baby steps. We're going to get there. Stay with me. We're going to get you just as empowered as you want to be. And I know that these steps are baby steps, but just bear with me. I've got time. You've got the rest of your life. Let's work together to see to it that you achieve everything in your life that you want, everything in your life that you need, that every significant relationship to you is a partnership, and not only that, that you learn to view every relationship as a partnership. Because if you approach it as a partnership, it will change the dynamic, even if the other person isn't on board. All right, so we're at the end of this video. Go ahead and stop it. Go down to the description below, find the link, download the guide that's gonna help you go through the steps that we've talked about. And you can watch this video again as you're doing that. And hopefully between what you see and what you hear, it will make sense and it will begin to fall into place. Now, next time, a little bit more about the agreement. And then we're gonna move on to what we just talked about and what we just introduced. Assertiveness. Assertiveness training is so important, especially in this culture where nobody is taught to be that and where very few people understand even what it is, much less how to practice it. I'm glad you're with me. I hope you'll be with me next time. Hope you'll watch all these videos. Hope you'll subscribe to the channel. I want you to succeed. And I guarantee you, if you will stick with this and utilize the tools that we will be presenting, you will succeed, guaranteed. Look forward to seeing you soon.